Welcome to another episode of Whitetail Rendezvous, coming to you 6 days a week as we interview whitetail experts and hear their traditions and personal stories of the hunt. Learn more about the latest gear, discover proven tips, and the latest strategies so you can make your next hunt a success. Now here's your host, Bruce Hutchin.
Whitetail Rendezvous is pleased to announce a partnership with GoHunt.com. Who's GoHunt.com? Well, if you're a DIY hunter, you need the information at gohunt.com/insider. Why? Because it provides 4,200 profiles, every unit, every species, and every season. Furthermore, they give in-depth analysis, interactive maps, unit access, and seasonal trends. Draws are very important, and they give you the most accurate information in the business. All this is available when you go to gohunt.com/insider. Make sure you use promo code WR when you join Insider. You'll get a $50 gift card for GoHunt.com gear shop. Remember, when you become a member of GoHunt.com/Insider, you're going to get a $50 gift card to GoHunt gear shop. What's in the gear shop? The best gear that you can buy for hunting the West. All in all, if you're hunting out West in 2018, GoHunt.com Insider is where you need to be to get all the research information. When you use promo code WR, Whitetail Rendezvous receives a small commission from GoHunt.com. Hey, folks, welcome back to Whitetail Rendezvous, special edition with Rackology. We're heading up to Eric and Jason's shop up there in Loup City, Nebraska. And this is the final segment of Food Plots, and we're going to talk about planting 365 and that kind of encompasses everything we talked about with these guys this week. And, you know, we started off with the land management, looking at the land, getting hard eyes on it, you know, fresh set of glasses, however you want to call it, and then figuring out where we're going to do things. And then we talked about the food plots and the seed, what they are, what they're not, and what they can't do. Now, you know, we're going to wrap it all up into a 365-day planting and growing session, if you will. So guys, let's bring forth some knowledge and share. And we did in the break we just had, we just talked about does are stressed, and I threw in my two cents. You know, the doe is bred in November 10th. She goes through December, January, February, March. Then she's, you know, sometime in the springtime she's going to have the fawn. And the better you can help them carry that fawn, the better deer herd you have. And that's what this is all about, is helping deer become healthy deer, liking your place to live on, and living there 365. So, guys, take it away.
All right. Well, you hit it right on the head. I mean, there's first key in planning a year-round program, whether it be feeding or food plots. When we talk about the land management, we kind of go – year over year. We don't just do this year and we're done. We'll see you next year and we'll just start a new game plan. Knowing the life cycle of what you're hunting or what you want out there is very important. I mean, Jason has taught me so much with his knowledge of not only biology, but in specific with deer herd development and deer herd health. I've learned, by just soaking in like a sponge next to him, hearing him talk to people and just asking questions, but knowing he knows really well that life cycle of a doe, the life cycle of a buck, and where you're going to be able to take the stress off of those animals. And like we were talking before, if there's more of a visual key to understand and see, you know, the stresses that these wild animals go through on a given year, because every year is not the same. On a dry year versus a wet year versus a cold winter year where you've got 20 snowfalls and 40 inches of snow. Those deer are out there. They don't get to go inside and relax and refresh and regroup for the next day like we do. But knowing that life cycle of the animal is huge when it comes to planting 365 year-round stuff. And, you know, a lot of people will see deer out there and not know how much stress that they've got on them. And they might just say, oh, they're eating out there. Look at all of them out there. They're just walking around and enjoying themselves and they're fine. You know, I don't need to do anything. Well, looking at trail camera pictures from closer than 50 to 100 yards, you're going to start picking up, like Jason has showed me, some things to key in on, okay, is that doe, you know, is she, I mean, she's got, you know, on a, what we don't know about the deer, I mean, there's a lot of times they have twins and triplets, and that's a lot of stress and vitamin and mineral and protein that that doe has got to do to get to that, to that fawn, whether it be a fawn that's a doe or a fawn that's a buck. And if you want them bucks to develop and to be their genetic potential, they need to be hit the ground running and they need to be efficient. So a lot of times the food plots and what you have on your land and water, areas that they could go in and drink on a daily basis. And then also the feed side of it, that's important to know what's out there naturally and what you could supplement them with. So I guess that's a key, a huge part. And you know, and I guess, and going into planning, like my grandpa always said, like everybody's grandpa said, I think, you know, measure twice and cut once, or, you know, you need to have a good MaTeC and Wovec and a good garage key. And so when I asked him, I said, well, what's a MaTeC? Well, that's a hammer. What's a Wovec? Well, that's a pencil.
Polish.
It's Polish for that. And he says, well, what's a garage key? He says, well, that's what you open the garage with. And I said, oh, okay. Now I know. But the planning is, is, you know, you got one time to do it. Just like I tell the farmers around here, they want to plant too early. They want to plant corn too early. They're looking at a calendar. When it comes to planting, I wish, you know, on when it comes to planting seeds in the ground, that we could throw the calendar away. We need to know where our soil temperatures are, and because you only have one time to do it. And if you do it a second time, it gets more expensive and less productive. You do it a third time, and it's probably not going to be productive at all, and it's going to be a lot more expensive. So you have one time to make this food plot shine. So do your homework and or call us and say, you know, when should I plant this? Okay, where's your soil temperature? Well, I don't know. Well, you can go get a thermometer at Walmart for a dollar. That it's just ground thermometer. You can stick it in the ground and we're going to plant that seed. So an inch to 2 inches and know exactly. Give it 5 minutes, read it. They make digital ones, you know, so it's something real simple will really help you. You till the ground, measure your soil temperature after you till it. Don't do it before you till it because it's going to warm it up when the sunlight hits it. So there's a lot of things that go into planting. And
soil temperature we're looking at.
Soil temperature, what you want for food plots, normally, unless you're frost seeding or doing something that there's some species that you could plant in the middle of winter. And they're fine, they're viable until the temperature reaches like 50 degrees, and then they start growing. Not all plants can do that. Normally, you want, you know, 55 degree temperature in your ground, you know, 50, 55 with a good 10-day forecast. You don't want to sit there and go into soil, oh, it's 50 degrees, and then you look at, you plant, and you look at the 10-day forecast, and they're calling for snow. They're calling for cold, wet rain. You're going to dry that soil temperature right back down pretty quickly. It takes a lot less time to cool the soil off than it does to raise the temperature. You usually want that about 55 degrees and a good 10-day forecast to start planting when to food. And like I said, a lot of people just pick a date on a calendar like, well, I'm just going to plant my food plot April 15th. April 15th, I've seen snow that's a foot and a half on the ground. So every year is different. And I've seen Aprils where it's been 80 degrees on the 15th in perfect conditions. So you just want to really time it right. And don't feel like you're going to get rushed in. Well, I only got this weekend to do it. You know, it might be worth it to try to really bust your butt and try to, if it's going to be the following weekend, it's going to be a better scenario to go into. Do it that following weekend. You know, do what you can to do that.
You know, for me, kind of getting back to, you know, what you kind of started talking about with the does, you know, and the bucks. If you're trying to grow a really healthy deer, you really can't think about what am I going to feed them in this small time frame. I mean, it does, it goes into not only planting 365, but planning 365. And that boils down to, you know, let's say the rut, for example. I've seen this just in the last, how many years, game camera pictures, watching the deer, you know, they've been using our Rackology products. And one thing I can say is if the deer are getting the proper nutrition, so if the bucks and does are really healthy when they're breeding, you know, so the sperm and the egg is at its prime, you know, it's the best nutrients that they can get. You know, if the sperm and egg are the healthiest possible when conception takes place, that fawn is going to be much better off genetics are going to be maximized that much more versus the fawn that maybe mom and dad didn't have a really good start. They didn't have the proper nutrition. So we had the same sperm and egg, but in a weaker capacity because of the lack of nutrition, we could birth those at the same date. Well, theoretically, do this. You know, this fawn that was conceived with proper nutrition is going to be so much better off, obviously, than the fawn that wasn't. I mean, we see this in humans. I mean, as a teacher, I see this with the different students. When we talk about students that have got learning disabilities, students that are, you know, all gamuts. And sadly enough, a lot of times it goes down to what did their parents do? You know, what were their parents doing before they were conceived? What a lot of that goes into the health of the child. Deer are no different. You know, they got proper nutrition before the rut and throughout the rut and after the rut. It's just a no-brainer. You're going to have healthier deer. And so, you know, with these planting these food plots, if you do it right and, you know, and can do the proper amount that, you know, you can do, whether it's the amount of acres that's an inhibiting factor for you or it's, you know, the dollar amount that's the inhibiting factor, you can, if you do the best you can do for those deer with your plots, you're going to notice the returns on it. I mean, that's just plain and simple. And, you know, and kind of to kickstart another conversation, because I'm going to go to him on this one. You go out there to get ready to start planting. And, you know, I'd mentioned this in the last segment, you know, you want to find out about your soil health. Soil sampling, if you can do it, is really awesome as far as figuring out what you're starting off with a base. And I guess my question for him, because maybe some of the listeners are going to be wanting to know this, is, you know, what pH, what is pH? What pH am I looking for? Once my pH is right, what are some other things that are going to, you know, kind of things that I'm going to look at before I even want to put seed in the ground and put you guys' fertilizer down? What are, you know, what is soil? What am I doing?
Mm-hmm. Well, I guess, you know, talking about soil health, we talked about it in that, you know, second section of this, but a lot of people don't know what is soil health. Is it just a thing that tells me, yeah, it's good or yeah, it's bad? It kind of takes a trained eye to look at the soil sample results and know what might be going on. And I've been using the word laboratories, and this is just a, I don't know if you can quite see that, but it just has all the breakdowns. This is just my field north of town here. And, you know, there's pH. And if you have a low pH, which is something under 6.5, percent, then you're going to have, you know, adding some lime, you know, get that pH level back up. There's soluble salts, there's organic matter, which is huge, carryover nitrogen, what you're going to have in all your nutrients, you know, your macros and micros with phosphorus, potassium, calcium, magnesium, molybdenum, manganese, zinc, iron, copper. I mean, there's just a whole gamut that you can learn. And when I get samples back, you know, depending on what crop's going in there, you know, I really go in here and I dive into it and figure out, you know, where the optimum level should be for what they want. And so what the optimum levels are going to be for corn is not going to be the same optimum levels for a food plot. And so
what's low pH due to a plant?
Well, when you look at pH is anything under 6.0 to like 5.5 to 6.0, I should say, will take your overall performance or production of a crop down by 10%. And then you get lower than 5.5, so it's like 4.5, you know, 5 to 5.5, I should say, takes about another 10. So you're down 20% production. So you can't expect to go plant something on a really low pH. It's 4.5 or 5 to and expect to have really good luck. You know, the optimum pH you want in your soil is, you know, 6.7 to 7. That's where you're going to have 100% potential of production, whether it be corn, food plot, or anything like that. Now, there are some species that do just fine on a more of a wide range of pHs, but you want to try to get that honed in as best as possible.
Does low soil pH, is that how it hurts the plant? Is it because it inhibits nutrient uptake?
Yes. Yeah, it ties up things. Low pH basically ties up some of your macros and micros, and it doesn't let the soil metabolize them and break them down as fast. And something that goes along with pH is your soil CECs, which is a sum of your cations that transfer a little particle of nitrogen from here to here, which looks like a long ways, but in a soil's eye, it's really small. So if you always thought about, well, if I put a little droplet, whether it be liquid or a granule of dry nitrogen, how does it get from there to my soil roots? Well, that a lot goes with your soil CECs, how it can transfer the broken down nitrogen from here to here to that root where the root intercepts it and takes it in, you know, and that's, I'm getting probably people falling asleep here with soil health, but I guess my only thing is when it comes to the planting size, when you're planting your food plots, your soil will tell you a lot if you're going to be successful or not. A lot of times I'll go out and we'll pick 7 different spots. Hey, guys got a quarter of ground, and I'm thinking this is where we picked on our planting discovery phase of the whole thing. We pull samples there. We send them to the lab, and 2 weeks later, I call them back. I says, well, you might as well go put a big X on plot 1 and plot 5, but the other 3 we could do some work with, and they're going to be more economical. So that could be a ruling thing where if people don't take a pH and or a soil test and the pH is off, a lot of times on pH, you could tell by the color of the soil if you're going to have a problem or not. The more you've got really light, like a piece of paper soil, and you've got really dark soil like this mouse here. And those two are not very good. You ever say the darker the soil, the better. You went right in the mix in between a brownish to a blackish soil. That's going to have probably your, because if it's too dark black and it's really going to have a lot of high organic matter and peat moss, and you're just going to have, it's the pHs are going to be really acidic. You have a really light color soil, a really light clay looking soil, it's going to be really alkaline. It's going to be really high in pH, which can affect it just like low pH can. You get upwards of 8%, 8.5%, it's going to hinder yourself too. So what I tell on the planting phase, for $13 for one sample to send in, it's worth it. I mean, if you're going to have spend $80 on or $150 on seed, why not spend $13 on a soil sample? So that's just, it goes along with, you know, not only where should I plant it, but when you put a soil test with maybe a geographical area where you're catching the right amount of sunlight and you're getting some subsoil irrigation, or you got some good holding capacity of water in your sample, then, you know, that's just as important.
You know, and that's where the tie that back into the first section of our series, land management. You know, I mean, when you walk your land, you know, listeners, you paid somebody to walk your land, get eyes on your land, do all this stuff. Every place you're considering putting in a food plot, spend the $13. I mean, you're already in, so you might as well go all in, and then it eliminates any questions, because you say, oh, this place right here, I can come to the backside of the ridge, the wind's here, I can slip in, great place for a stand, and that's where I want the food plot, and then it won't grow, you know, as we talked earlier in the show, you're trying to grow, brassicas on dolomite, and it ain't going to work.
One thing I found out, though, is what can be a side detriment of that happening. I've always come to the reasoning that the plants you want to grow and thrive in an area that you don't do your homework on won't thrive, but weeds will. And so if you till up an area and you just don't think and don't do a soil sample, you till it up, you plant it, nothing comes up, something's going to have to come up, unless it's just barren soil that maybe has something, a much deeper issue going on. When you till that up and you take all the coverage off of there, and the pHs or some of the soil fertility is wrong, and it doesn't come up, and all of a sudden it comes midsummer, and you got weeds galore. You got, now some weeds are beneficial for some species, but you got the weeds you don't want, and you end up having to spray it or till it again. And do your due diligence and just do a soil test, because before you go ripping up a piece of ground.
Yeah, there's just no question about it. Now, you know, folks, takes a dough about a fun to come about 201 days, so November, December, you can count it out. But all through that carrying time, that's, as we talked about before, that's the most critical time for that fawn. And that's why, you know, planting 365 is becoming more and more important. No matter how little you think you're doing a lot. Your thoughts?
Well, you know, for me, I you know, originally started coming up with these products just for ourselves, the one thing I looked at was not so much as, you know, how big of a buck can I grow? You know, granted, we all want to, you know, possibly shoot a nice buck. I mean, that's a lot of hunters are looking at the antlers. But for me as a biologist, common sense would tell you if you have the most healthiest does and fawns possible, it's just a no-brainer that your bucks are going to naturally, you know, you're going to, the point is we want to maximize their genetic potential. The bucks maximize the genetic potential of does. And so by creating a year-round possibility for feeding, you know, the bucks, the deciding factor on the antlers is throughout the winter months and into the spring months. The deciding factor on how healthy them fawns are going to be when they're born is those winter months and what they got to eat, you know, what type of cover they've got. You know, we've got a bedding cover that we've got on our website that, you know, places where people don't have a bedding spot on their ground, they can provide that for the deer. It gives them a place to take shelter, especially if you can get it someplace next to where we got water. There is some food source in that plot as well with some of the other plants we got in there, but you couple that with a good healthy plot and either A, one, make it big enough that it's going to last into the winter months, or B, you know, you fence it so that you take down the fence so it's optimum for hunting, and you might, you know, put it back up to salvage what remains so that they've got something to graze on over the winter months. It just depends on how much ground you have, how much, you know, how much you're able to plant. You know, there's other things that go into planting. I mean, if you go into a little area into the trees and you think this is a nice place for a plot and I'm going to plant it, you kind of, you know, figure out your directions a little bit in the trees and think about where the sun is. You know, those of you that put out game cameras realized after not too long that you don't point your game cameras east and you don't point your game cameras west unless you're in a really shaded spot. Otherwise, the sun gets sun flash, right? Same way with the food plot. When you're in there, you know where the sun's coming up and going down. If the plot's getting way too much sun because it's way out in the open, or it's in the trees and it's too dark, and you got to pay attention to how much you might have to cut some trees back even further than where your plot sits, you know, to open up. Like on my, you know, mine was a 1/8 acre plot. I probably had, I bet you, maybe 10 to 20 yards ish of open outside the plot before it got to the first trees, just to make sure that I had, you know, X amount of daylight, you know, hitting it. Not only that, when you do go to cut down some of those trees, think about what you're doing when you're cutting them. You can hinge cut them, or cut them and drag them into certain areas. The one place where we're hunting at, there's so many ways that these deer come through the trees to the plot that you can help to kind of funnel them through an area to your plot. So not only are you thinking about the deer's health when they're doing these plots, but you're also thinking about strategics as far as, you know, what, you know, where are these deer going to be coming from? Then kind of back to the health aspect, this is my sporadicness, I guess you have to put up with, is those fawns in the spring and summer months when they're needing milk, you know, they're needing the nutrition, they're needing it now. Those bucks that are growing the antlers may have kind of been decided back in February, March, April, but they still need to replace on their skeleton now what they're pulling off to grow the antlers. Those fawns, those does, they need to replace the nutrients and the minerals that they're taking out of their body to put into the milk for those fawns. So they need that over the summertime. And so it's not just a let's plant it a little bit here and it's a one and done and then we forget about it. You know, those deer need different nutritional requirements throughout the year. And, you know, if you plant a monoculture, mono means one. So it's a one type of plant. It'd be like planting all corn or all soybeans. When you plant a monoculture, those plants are good, you know, a certain time of the year. If you're planting plots that have got a number of different varieties, it's kind of like they can go to the store and they can choose. This week, I kind of like these plants. This week, I kind of like those plants. You know, the nutritional value is different, you know, depending on the time of the year with those plants. And so, you know, can you get by just filling up a little 1/4 acre, an 1/8 acre plot? And, you know, let's say like you just want, you know, we've got guys that want to just throw out our brassica mix. They don't do the soil sample. Can you get away with that? Sure you can. You know, not everybody's going to go out and buy the soil sample because they might think, well, this is too small to do it. In the long run, is it going to be better? Of course, because if you're going to continue to plant that area, you know, anything that you can do, that you want to do, that you can afford to do, whatever, for a plot, is not going to be for naught, you know, in the future. It's going to boil down to, you know, what do you want to see on that ground in a year or two or 5 years? So,
you know, this last half hour just really flew by, and we gave a lot of, you know, not just biscuits and gravy either, you know, meat and potatoes. And folks, you know, Recology can reach by how?
Our email is probably one of the best ways to get a hold of us, just because, you know, we're both at work during the day and whatnot, but it's RecologyLLC@gmail.com. Instagram and Facebook, you know, guys that follow us, they often message us through there. Problem with messaging through there is notifications don't always go through. And so, you know, there's been times where it's a few days later that I noticed made messages on Instagram, and I apologize, and they're usually good with it and everything. It's just, you know, email's probably the best. Our website, you can get in contact with us through there, but I'd say email's the best. And if we need to, we can always follow up with a phone call, you know. Mm-hmm. Our website's racology.org.
So, guys, Eric and Jason, thanks so much for spending a couple hours with Whitetail Rendezvous and bringing this information to our listeners. And, you know, we've got to get smarter, one, with our dollar, two, with our time, and, you know, and really consider being, you know, 365 hunters, as I call it, because, you know, all throughout the year, we're helping our deer herd grow. And that's what I want to help all you listeners to do. So, guys, on behalf of thousands of listeners across North America, thanks for being part of this special series on land management and food plots.
All right, thanks for having us, Bruce.
Yeah, appreciate it.
Hey, folks, a special edition of Whitetail Rendezvous is coming. I've asked three companies, Land & Legacy, Recology, and Grandpa Ray Outdoors, to be part of a series on land management and food plots. So the next few episodes, about 18 of them, in fact, are going to be about land, either land management or food plots. Why? Because people have been asking me a lot of questions. So I went out and chatted with some guys, and Adam Keith and Matt Dye from Land & Legacy is joining the crew. And at Recology, we have Jason Obermiller and Eric Fitzgerald. And rounding out the team is Grandpa Ray Outdoors with John O'Brien. Each of them is going to bring a different flavor in what is land management, what are food plots, why you need them, the pros and cons. So listen up to this next series, and I sure hope you like them. If you like them, let me know. If you don't like them, let me know what I can do better. Thanks.
Thanks for joining us. Be sure to tune in tomorrow for another episode of Whitetail Rendezvous, where you can listen and learn from the experts so you can be more successful on your next hunt. Until next time, listen, learn, and succeed.